Hello, everybody. So today we have Siva Prasad Das. Professor Siva, he studied at Jadavpur University at India, the bachelor degree, the master, and the PhD. After that, he was a postdoc in Germany, in the Bond Institute. And also, he also have a postdoc at Spain, in Valencia University. And after that, he has been in different institutions as a researcher. He has been researcher in, for example, in Mexico, in Puebla, at the BUAP University in Puebla. And he has also been in Colombia. And right now he's visiting La University del Valle in Guatemala. So welcome, Siva, and thanks a lot for being here. Today he's going to give two talks. Today he's going to try to make a little understand all these problems of supersymmetry and high energy. And the next Wednesday he will also talk a little more deeper. So welcome Siva, and we are ready.
Thank you so much, Professor Brambilla, and I'm extremely happy that this is my first online seminar. In my life, and I'm also very. My first colloquium was at Simbesta, and my first online seminar is also from Guatemala to the Mexican UNAM Mathematics Department. But I'm also extremely grateful to Dr. Giovanni Ramirez, who basically introduced me in that particular seminar series. In fact, I like to listen to seminars and colloquium, and it's really good for me. And I'm also grateful for the people in Guatemala, in the University del Valle, Professor Zaida Urrutia, and also the professor from USAC, Dr. Rodrigo Sacahuy, who basically took me from Bogota, Colombia to Guatemala. So I'm extremely grateful to all of you that I will present what we are working on. So today, basically, I would like to discuss about mostly the phenomenology conversion, but certainly the formalism part should be come before and then the phenomenology, but because of a little bit of preparation, I just changed the mode. But today, let us discuss with a brief discussion on supersymmetry phenomenology at high energy colliders. So this basically the introduction, this basically the outline, but I would like to do it very quickly, the last part of that, which is not at the moment I'm working on. So these are more or less like introduction, but don't worry about the 102. I will finish it around 60 pages before. So in fact, everybody not at the moment, but in 2010-12, people are working because that is the time where the Higgs physics was very important, and people are trying to look for the Higgs boson. So these are the theory that's governed, which is the Lagrangian. And these are the first term, which is the electromagnetic field tensor. And del mu phi, which is the gauge covariant, the gauge covariant kinetic term for the scalar field, which is the phi. And there is a potential, which is like a simple potential, which is called the phi, v phi. And this completely describes the Abelian Higgs model. And there are varieties of like a structure of the potential formulation. For example, what is the V phi, which is like a mu square phi square plus lambda phi 4. This is a very famous like a lambda phi 4 theory, which is like a so normally in the scalar field, the phi square is basically the mass term, and these are kind of an interaction which is called the quartic coupling or the phi 4 interaction. By convention, lambda is kind of some kind of a coupling, is like a four coupling. So by convention, normally lambda is greater than zero, but there are two cases, which is like which is the mass term mu square. So mu square could be greater than zero or mu square could be less than zero. if you go to the mu square greater than zero, if you plot the potential looks like that. Yeah. So this has an unique minima, which is as phi is equal to zero. And that basically the gauge boson, which is the MA for that particular potential, which is basically massless. And mass of the scalar, which is exactly like a mu, which is just like the quantum electrodynamics in our normal sense. But if you go to the other mu square less than zero, which is that one, which is basically called the Mexican hat potential. So this is basically the metastable vacuum. So which is the now phi is equal to zero is the metastable. But if you move phi is equal to V, you shift your field up to V from the origin, and then you try to expand your Lagrangian again. And you will see that I break the vacuum by this vacuum expansion value. And this is basically the E1 symmetry breaking. So the question here is that who tells me that mu square is less than zero? Because we need that, because I know that the vacuum is breaks E1. So this I directly confirm to the standard model to the MSSM potential, which is basically the scalar potential VH. So in the next week, I will try to explain you how you can construct the scalar potential from a superfield formalism. But let us assume that this is the scalar potential. Similarly, the first term like M square, H square, M square, M2 square, H2 square. So here you think about that H1 is equal to some kind of a phi 1, H2 is equal to some kind of a phi 2. And these are the corresponding mass term of this corresponding Higgs, as well as there is a mixing term, which is called the mu b, that is required because of the electric symmetry breaking. Because even though you have an MSSM, but the MSSM has a larger group, but it has an embedding of the standard model. And to get the Higgs, you need an electric symmetry breaking. So this basically triggered the electric symmetry breaking when you minimize the potential. And there is a construction by the supersymmetry that we'll also discuss about, that this is some kind of the quartic coupling that I discussed to you, which is like a lambda phi 4, like H1 whole square and H2 square, that means H1 to the power 4. So this means this G square plus G prime square by 8, which is some kind of mimicking of the quartic coupling. But G and G prime is the gauge coupling of the standard model, the G prime, which is like E1 gauge coupling, and G is the SU2 gauge coupling. And by the construction of the supersymmetry that I will discuss in the next week, that by construction of the supersymmetry, this quartic coupling of the standard model, Abelian Higgs model, is fixed by the gauge coupling in that way. Yeah. So it's a very like a compact construction. In addition, there is also another like a H1 square, H2 square term. So these are the three independent parameter, like a mu square, M square, mu 2 square, M2 square, and mu B must be non-zero for the electric symmetry breaking take place. So why we need the electric symmetry breaking? Because I know that once you get the symmetry, the electric sector is symmetry breaking spontaneously, then I should have an W and Z boson mass, which is necessary for our standard model requirement, and the masses of the W boson, which is fixed by the vacuum expectation value of the two scalar field, like a V1 and V2. Because before in the Abelian Higgs model, I have an one scalar doublet, but since I have a two scalar doublet, that is also requirement from the, when you extend from the standard model to the supersymmetry because of various requirement, for example, the anomaly cancellation, for example, you need a two Higgs doublet model. And this V1 and V2 are the vacuum expectation value of the two Higgs doublet model, and their ratio, which is also kind of an input parameter, which is called the tan beta. And in the tree level, that means you don't have any higher loop calculation, for example, one loop or two loop theory. So let us assume that I'm working on the tree level, which is the approximately tree level. So this tan beta and mu beta completely describe the scalar sector of the MSSM. So now, as I said to you, that the question was that who tells me that mu square less than zero? So even in the MSSM, even in the supersymmetry formalism, there are various kind of a supersymmetry breaking. For example, I will discuss in the next class that there is a soft supersymmetry making, there is a minimal supersymmetry, supergravity mediation breaking, there is an anomaly mediated supersymmetry breaking, there is an gauge mediated supersymmetry breaking, there is various formation of the supersymmetry could be breaks, just like the electric symmetry breaking. For supersymmetry to be break, this is a simple model where I have an five parameter supersymmetry breaking, which is called the minimal supergravity, where the M0 MHAP and mu square plus M0, these are the three parameter, and there is a 10 beta, which is the ratio of vacuum expectation value, and there is an another parameter, which is called the trilinear coupling. So if you give in the supersymmetry as an input with this five parameter, and you assume that I am working on the minimal supergravity, and then you run the renormalization group, because the supergravity is also based on the SO10 or some other model SU5. So those are the like a group theoretical aspect. So by this group theory, so if you run all these parameter from the supergravity from the high scale, let us assume that the my unification is at the Planck scale or the GARD scale, which is 10 to the power 16 GeV. If you start from the GARD scale, if you run to the renormalization group up to the electric symmetry breaking scale, which is of the order of 100 GeV, is it is in the mass range of the W or the Z boson, you see that I have an MHU, which is like a up soft Higgs mass parameter that basically going back to the negative, which is going to the negative. And this basically triggers the electric symmetry breaking in the minimal supergravity scenario. So this is the requirement that I should have, even I have a minimal supergravity, I should have an electric symmetry breaking at this electric scale. And these are the running of these other mass parameter. For example, M1, M2, M3, these are like a U1, SU2, SU3, Gagino mass parameter, which is also some kind of a particle of the supersymmetry that will manifest in the electric scale. And the Large Hadron Collider or all these high energy collider experiment try to look the y-axis of the mass range of the particle in the experiment. Yeah. So because our experiment is running in the electric breaking scale. So the most important is that the uptide Higgs soft mass becomes negative, and that triggers the electric symmetry breaking at that electric scale. So as I said, that radioactive electric symmetry breaking, because this is also fixed, the masses of the Z boson. So you have a 10 beta, you have an up and down Higgs soft mass, and I have a mu square term. So if you go a little bit of algebra, this is very important relation for a moderately large 10 beta. So you can have a very linear relation. Remember that MHU square is equal to negative. That means negative, negative gives me positive. And this has a cancellation, like a soft up Higgs parameter and mu square, the cancellation will be such that I exactly get the right ballpark of the Z boson value, the masses of the electric scale. So that is also requirement for the naturalness criteria, fine tuning criteria. Those are all mimicking, and I will try to explain you in the next day how it comes. So this is called the mu problem. So now the question is that mu is an arbitrary parameter. So now the question is that what is the value of the mu in the MSSM superpotential? Because I need, this is called some kind of a bilinear term, because I have a two scalar field, HU and HD, they coupled with the mu. This is not exactly mass term, because mass term requires the self field, like a M square, HU square, HU square. But this is a bilinear term because I have an up and the Higgs, like a two Higgs doublet, they have a coupling together with the mu term. Highly suppressed, but cannot be completely forbidden. For example, if mu is equal to zero, that means this term is goes away. That means no mixing between the up and the down sector of the scalar sector, because we need a mixing. For example, there is a Pechiquin symmetry, which is because if you, in the next day, probably I will discuss about that. Suppose if you, all the superfield in the superpotential or in the Lagrangian of a superpotential. So there is a particular Pechiquin charge that you assign. And if mu is equal to zero, and particularly this mu HU HD term, this basically violates the Pechiquin symmetry. So if, because I need that Pechiquin symmetry to be violated, because I should have, if mu is equal to zero, that means the Pechiquin symmetry is not violated, then I will have a problem with a massless axion. I should have an mu is equal to non-zero term to get the Pechiquin symmetry breaking. For example, there is also another experimental evidence, for example, in 2000 or so, the large electron positron experiment that was at the CERN, it was closed that, but they put a very strong limit on the supersymmetry charginal mass. The charginal is nothing but the supersymmetry partner of the W plus minus boson. W plus minus is the discovery, the basic gauge bosons of the standard model. So they explain that for mu, that should be greater than 100 GeV to get a correct charginal mass of 105 GeV. Yeah. For example, the other value of the mu, which is the natural mass scale value, which is either Gut scale or the Planck scale, then the Higgs or Higgsinos are very high. You need a very high fine tuning. So you encounter the problem of the naturalness. You reinterpret the problem of the naturalness of the hierarchy problem, reintroduced again after solving the supersymmetry. So this is also avoiding that the mu is equal to m Gut or m Planck. For phenomenological acceptable solution, the value of the mu, which is the mass dimension, that should be order of the supersymmetry breaking scale, which is of the order of 2 TeV at the moment. So this M SUSY is like a supersymmetry breaking scale, at which scale the supersymmetries breaks. So normally it is the scale below that people, the high energy collider experiment, try to find any super partner around that scale M SUSY. So which is of the order of, at the moment, 2 TeV to 3 TeV. That we'll also discuss about that, how the 2 or 3 TeV is basically important. So let us go back from the MSSM to the next to MSSM, because this solves the mu problem, because mu was a free parameter in the MSSM. But once you go to the next to MSSM, you have an extra handle to generate the mu term by some spontaneous breaking. For example, here, which is also called the superpotential of the Higgs. So other than the MSSM only contains mu HU HD term. Yeah, so these are only the MSSM term. But there you see that there is a new term, which is like S tilde. So this is called the scalar superfield. Yeah, so this, the linear term, which is called the tadpole term, S square, which is like a mass term, S cube, which is like a trilinear interaction. In addition, I have a bilinear term, which is like a lambda S HU HD. So this term, this Higgs superpotential has, this is the S superfield potential. And there is also another, which is called the Yokoi potential, that is also important, because in the standard model, I will also tell you in the next day that Yokoi is a very important, this is just like a Yokoi interaction, like a Yokoi potential. So Yokoi interaction is important to get the masses of the charged lepton or the quark in spontaneously. For example, whenever the Higgs get the vacuum expectation value, then you get a mass term of the Q square, like a Schreiber-Shy, which is like a fermion. So that means M Schreiber-Shy is the corresponding mass term of the corresponding fermion or the quark in the superpotential. And there is a soft, which means that I will also tell you in the next day that what is the soft means. So this soft means this Lagrangian term of the superpotential. So if you make a supersymmetry transformation of this Lagrangian soft, you see that this L soft is not a supersymmetry invariant. So that means this is not supersymmetry breaking term, but it is softly, because the mass dimension of the scalar, which is less than 4. Yeah, I will also discuss about that in the next day. But this is like a, there is also another important point, which is called the Zeta symmetry, because if you see that this Yokoi term, as well as the lambda S HU HD term and kappa SQ term, which is some kind of an like a discrete symmetry, which is like a ZC symmetry. You can think about that. If I rotate all the field by 2 pi I by 3, then I have an invariant superpotential term. But only when, if you have like a xi s is equal to 0, xi f is equal to 0, because those are the like a single term or the double term, they are not the Z3 invariant. So the Z3 invariant only, I should have a 3 types of field that should be present. So that means if I have a Z3 invariant term, so then I have an only trilinear term like S, HU, HD, and SQ. So assume that it is some kind of a quantum number like e to pi I by 3. So now you assume that I got the vacuum expectation value of the S. Let us assume that the S is a scalar superfield. So this got an, this should be neutral. So whenever you generate any vacuum expectation value of the superfield, that should be a neutral, because otherwise your vacuum breaks the charge symmetry. But the vacuum is always conserved the E1 EM, yeah, the electromagnetic charge. So that means whenever the vacuum expectation value of the S gets the lambda S, yeah, so then you breaks the Z3 symmetry again, because I have an kappa 3 by VQ or kappa 3 by SQ, because you don't have the field anymore. So that means you spontaneously break the Z3 symmetry by inserting the vacuum expectation value of the singlet superfield. And eventually you generate an effective mu term, which is like a coupling lambda, and ACE, and that is basically serve the purpose of the effective mu term of the MSSM, and you can tune the value of the lambda and ACE such that you are in the correct ballpark from the phenomenological point of view of the mu value of the that is the requirement from the theoretical and the phenomenological expectation. So that's the idea that NMSSM solves the mu problem by this way. Yeah, but there are many varieties of like a topological defect and electric symmetry breaking, cosmic background radiations are related with all the Z3 and the PHE twin symmetry. Those are very rich phenomenology. So let us focus on the Higgs physics at the moment. So I have an Higgs potential. So these are the 7 parameters that I started with, and these are the Higgs potential. And you do similarly like electric symmetry breaking, and you see that you have an corresponding radiative electric symmetry breaking. And I have a 6 parameter because I know the Z boson mass. So 7 to 6, this is by the minimization of the scalar potential because that gives the masses of the corresponding scalar into our theory. So there are also another important part because I have extended from doublet Higgs model, which is the MSSM, to I introduced an scalar singlet, which is like S. So that means since it is a mixing, so my enlarged Higgs, my scalar sector is basically enlarged. Yeah. So now I have a 3 scalar, H1, H2, H3. Now these are the neutral Higgs scalar in my NMSSM model. Yeah. In addition, there is also coupling. This is called the Yoko coupling, like H1 BB bar or H1 TT bar. So those are very important because these are the Yoko coupling are responsible for the getting the generation of the masses of the top quark or generating the masses of the B quark. Yeah, their coupling are very, very important from the phenomenological perspective. But that means that you enlarge your theory. But remember that I should have a coupling. So that means you cannot really tolerate the coupling very much. Then you have a problem with other constraint. Yeah. So that means even though you enlarge, but not everything is free. You have to keep in mind that I have an issue of the coupling that should be fixed with the that should be consistent with the experiment. Yeah. Because standard model Higgs either H1 is also coupling changes and hence the branching ratio, because if I have an more than one decay mode, and that is the discovery mode of the corresponding scalar or any other supersymmetric or the standard model particle, their branching ratio will change and their rate will change. That will come. So there is another interesting sector, which is the neutral, you know, because these are the supersymmetric neutral Gaugino sector. For example, these are the E1 Gaugino, these are the SU2 Gaugino, and these are the SU2 Gaugino, some kind of like a 14O. W Chargino or the Gluino. And this is also enlarged because I have a singlet. The singlet is also because the superfield formalism also, superfield formalism is very important because the superfield basically take care of the scalar and the corresponding superpattern of the scalar, which is a fermion together. So that means since you addition of the S, so this is also increased your fermion sector, and the neutral, you know, is also enlarged from 4 to 4 to 5 cross 5. And chi10, which is like a very important for the dark matter phenomenology, those who works on the dark matter aspect. So you will see that this also the compositions of the chi10 that is also changed, and that substantially changes the dark matter phenomenology. So you have to also keep in mind that whenever you do any kind of a change of the parameter, you have to keep in mind that I'm working on the dark matter right. For example, here. So these are the very one slide for the dark matter. I also don't know much about the dark matter. In the dark matter, there is a parameter which is called the Cohen-Ellison cross section, which is like a omega chi. Chi is the neutralino, and H square is like a Hubble constant. So this is of the order of 0.1 pico into velocity of light. So you can think about that I have an annihilation cross section if it is 0.1 pico one. And if the relative velocity between the two particle, for example, one chi10, chi10, if it is the velocity very close to C, if their annihilation cross section is 0.1 pico one, then you are in the correct ballpark of the W map of the standard cosmology scenario for the dark matter. This is a very, very, the basic part that I know only. There are large people are working on dark matter phenomenology. There are substantial working last 10 years, but I don't know. But let us assume that because of this enlargement of the particle spectrum in our spectrum, NMSSM, so these are kind of a new decay mode that you could have it. So that means I have also new annihilation cross-section, so that you have to take care also that whether your annihilation cross-section gives that correct ballpark. In fact, this is one of our paper, and then we check that that is the green is the perfect spectrum where you could have a correct W umbrella. So these are not really important, but just to let you know that these are the parameter from the phenomenological point of view, from the experimental collaboration. So whenever you do anything phenomenology, you have to keep in mind that you cannot do anything arbitrary. You have to restore all the bounds on the perturbative, B physics, S particle marks, and so and so. And then only if you have a certain allowed parameter space, then only you can do the phenomenology of anything new. So Large Hadron Collider. So there are basically 10 different experiments. That is a little bit probably older. There are a few more experiments that is going to happen in the Large Hadron Collider. But for the discovery, for any discovery of the new particle, normally the ATLAS and the CMS, a direct discovery. There is also like an indirect discovery. Yeah, there is like an indirect interpretation. But for a direct discovery, you need a high energy threshold. And ATLAS and the CMS, which are the main high energy threshold, that is basically responsible for any discovery of a new physics. Just like what I said in the RG equation, that's the Y scale, the Y axis of the deformation group equation. Yeah, that's the which my scale I am working on. So discovery is a very important aspect. So people are working on that, but this is a lot of complicated statistical tools used by the experimentalist. But the idea is in a nutshell is that I have to know that we have a signal that is inconsistent with being a background, because background is already known. Yeah, for example. Now in the experiment, you basically first you extract you only store data, you don't know anything else, you only save the data, but you know the background very well. So then you check that whether did I find any excess, which is like n data minus background. And I know that from statistical fluctuation that any number could be fluctuate over root n background, and there is a significance which is called the S over root V. And if I found the significance is 5 sigma, which is of the order of the fluctuation is 5.7 into 10 to the power 7. That means if I found something new, yeah, within 5 sigma, suppose if it is a 5 sigma, the significance is 5 sigma. That means I found something new, that my interpretation to find something new is wrong. The probability of my finding is wrong is 5.7 into 10 to the power minus 7. That means a very, very small number. That means to a certainty that I got something new. So this is called the significance, which is called the 5 sigma discovery. Normally in the experiment, you will see that sometimes the people say, hey, we have a 10 femtoman luminosity. After 1 year, they increase the luminosity. If you increase the luminosity, normally the significance will be increase over time by acquiring more data. For example, what is signal and what is background? For example, let us assume that I have an Higgs. Higgs can decay into the gamma, which is like a photon. Yeah, or Higgs can also discover in the tau or BB or dielectron or any. These are the channel that you are trying to look for the Higgs in a new mode. But there is also like a gamma Z directly from the collision. Yeah, so that means this is some kind of a Drellian background. So that means this gamma directly coming from the initial collision from the proton. But this process, this is basically the process where my gamma is coming via a mediation, which is like a Higgs. Yeah. So that means if you make an invariant plot mass of these two photons, you get a kind of an invariant mass peak, which is a Lorentz invariant, of course. So then you get a mass peak of the Higgs, and that is basically show that where could be my Higgs particle. So these are like the people on the experimentalist and the phenomenologist. I do phenomenology. So we basically try to model various kind of a selection. For example, PTE, rapidity, missing energy, invariant mass, effective mass, RLL, transverse rapidity, longitudinal aquaplanarity. The various kind of a selection depending upon your phase space of your distribution of the particle, and you try to figure it out that in which region I have a signal population and which region I have a low background region. So you try to make with all these tricks. With now people are working with the machine learning, people are really working on the machine learning, artificial intelligence to get into that business, that to find the signal rich region or the background poor part of the face space with a neural network. But this, I said, the TMBA, which is like an old version of the neural network. People are working neural network now. So assume that experiments observe something new, for example, top, Higgs, or beyond standard, then interpret the result in some available theoretical models. For example, in our disposal standard model, MSSM, NMSSM, GMSB, minimal supergravity, or any model. So the model as a whole or part of it are consistent with the finding. If then I call that, hey, part of the model is allowed, or these regions of the model space is allowed with the consistent with theory and experiment. If not, is ruled out, not always completely ruled out. For example, if you see the gluino mass at the present supersymmetry large hadron collider experiment, which is almost of the order of 3 TeV or 2.5 TeV. So that means it is very close that minimal supergravity is basically probably ruled out from the gluino mass search. But there are many pockets are there that still you can survive the minimal supergravity but those are, as I said, those are not very important at the moment. So last 2 or 3 years since I came to Mexico, in fact, Professor Alfonso Rosado and Jaime Hernandez Sanchez from the BUAP, they basically told me, Shiva, can we do something on the LHC? Before I was working on Large Hadron Collider. So you put a small e here, that means I have an electron ring, and I have a Large Hadron Collider has an PP collision, and I have an electron sometimes, which is 60 GeV, and proton is a 7 TeV from the LHC. They have an root S, which is 1.3 TeV, which is of the order of the tevatron energy scale, which is closed in Fermi Lab 10 years before. But it is the order of the order of the tevatron energy scale that you can probe any new physics at the TeV scale. Yeah, and then there is a recent upgradation, which is called the FCC. FCC is like a future circular collider that was supposed to happen in the China. But they have, it was supposed to happen in the Sun, but there is also VLHC or CEPC. But FCC is like a 50 TeV, and this is of the order of 3. So whenever you see the value 1.3 TeV or 3.5 TeV, so this means this is the scale that I can maximally reach to the new scale of any physics, or like a M supersymmetry. That means if supersymmetry exists below 1.3 TeV, I may find. If the supersymmetry exists below 3.5 TeV, I may find in that machine. So these are kind of a threshold that how far you can reach your supersymmetry mass scale. So these are the construction. This is at the CERN, yeah, because this is the LHC. This is at the CERN FCC. So this is a very important, it is the early days because these are the Jefferson Lab HERA LHC, and now the FCCHC is here. But very important point is that there is a pattern distribution function on the Bjorken X. So the LHC, it can reach up to the Bjorken X, which is like a 10 to the power 6 or 10 to the power minus 7, and it can reach to the Q square is of the order of 10 to the power 6 GeV. FCCHE can also extend this part even much larger, yeah? But these are like, so what is important for the X? The X is important because this will give you the pattern distribution function of the proton, that what is the scale of the pattern distribution function? Because if you probe in the proton, because proton has a consistent of an quark, there are kind of a C quark, valence quark, and so and so. So normally in the low X, you can see the valence quark. But if you go to the very high small X physics, then basically you see that I have a C quark flux, which is like which could be enhanced, and that will trigger a new kind of a process, and that you can show up. This is a very important. The left plot is a very very important plot for the collider physics, because it will tell you, suppose I want to calculate the masses of the 100 GeV of the Higgs, then you see that there is an 6, 4, 2, 2, 4, 6. So these are kind of a rapidity, and you can see the corresponding Bjorken X. So that means suppose I want to find a 100 GeV Higgs in the rapidity region 4, then you'll see that this rapidity region 4, sorry, this rapidity region 4 corresponds to the x, which is 10 to the power minus 5. Now you know the very well the pattern distribution function in the proton. Then you check that at this x, which is 10 to the power minus 5, which fraction of the proton quark is very large. So then try to use that particular flux in your process that could be triggered a higher cross section or higher number of events. This is a very, very important plot to finding the idea of the rapidity range and the Bjorken x and the threshold value of any particular new physics that you are looking for and in which channel. For example, here we try to get the Higgs mass and from the gauge boson fusion channel, for example, WW or ZZ, these are the gauge boson coupling with the Higgs because the gauge boson is also get the masses from the electric symmetry baking. When the Higgs get the vacuum expression value, you get the masses of the W and the Z boson. So, but these are like a trilinear coupling. So that means the Higgs here is not basically get the wave. There could be a quartic coupling. I have another Higgs. For example, suppose here I have a quartic coupling, which is like a lambda phi 4, but now one Higgs get the wave. For example, I put a wave of the one neutral Higgs, then I have a three prong. So this becomes a three coupling, but here the lambda and one of the vacuum expression value of the Higgs is basically placed to the roles of the coupling here. So this is called the gauge boson fusion channel. And this is a very useful channel to look for the Higgs in the LHC machine. So these are very important aspect of this T channel. You know the Mandelstam variable. So there are like a S channel, there are T channel, there are U channel. So normally the gauge boson fusion channel, which is called the vector boson fusion. So the T channel is very important. And here is basically the hard scattering cross section from the VA to X. What is V? V is the gauge bosons. So you can parameterize that I have a gauge boson is emitting from a particular fermion channel. And these gauge bosons and with another A particle is basically getting a capital X particle. And this is basically the convolution. These are basically similar like a pattern distribution function that what is the fraction of that I can emit a photon, I can emit a gauge boson from a fermion and you convolute with the pattern distribution function and the DPT. So these are the allowed range. And once you do the whole cross section, you get the whole cross section. So this left-hand side is important because this is basically give you the how many number of signal event that I may get it. Yeah. So this is a very important relation. And you see that for large PT, normally the transverse gauge bosons are very important from this expression. This is a famous work by Sally Dawson and Maria Guillard long before. So this is basically the phenomenological part that I do for the phenomenology, but experimentalists do a lot of new stuff, lot of boosted decision tree, neural network, but the basic idea is saying that you have to really fix all these parameters. And then you do the phenomenology, you try to get parameter space scan because you have a multidimensional parameter space. You get the scan, you get the correct value. For example, these are the range where I have a correct value of the Higgs mass. And these are the green that you get for your new discovery region that can we find something, anything in this new green region? This is also like an event rate, as I said, that event rate is like a number of signal event that how much is the number of signal event that I am getting. It is some kind of a N of data minus N of background that I told you before. So N of data is like a signal plus background and N of background is the background. So these are like, I'm expecting in our Monte Carlo, in our computer simulation Monte Carlo of having this hard cross section, getting the convolution that I'm expecting that I am, if I go for this gauge boson fusion mode, I'm expecting that I'm having this much number of N data minus N background. Yeah. So this is my expectation for my Monte Carlo. Yeah? And then with, as I said, that I really didn't discuss much about, but I think this is more or less like an Higgs reconstruction, as I said, that invariant mass is one of the important aspects for the discovery. And for example, when Higgs goes to gamma or Higgs goes to TT bar or something, so you have to generate the Higgs mass. So if you see a peak over the background, that means here something new is there. So this is basically our analysis from one of our work with the two Higgs doublet model with Professor Alfonso Rosado, Jaime, and Stefano Moretti, and Reina Zozokotsi is a student of Jaime. when I was visiting Bua. So then basically we also did like a, these are nothing but the kinematics. So basically you are understanding the phase space particle of the decay. And you try to get, have a feelings that by Monte Carlo that which region I have a signal rich or which region I have a background poor. But from a very naive at the moment, now for the timing, it's a very naive approach. But now people are working much smarter with CNN, like a neural network and booster decision tree, even booster decision tree, even old. So CNN, ANN, artificial neural network, people can use that now. So this, please don't understand all this. So last, just as I said that I want to get some 5 sigma. And here you see that I got 2.2 sigma. Here I see that I got around 1.54 sigma. So that means I do all kind of analysis with taking care of the background. But you see that I don't have any 5 sigma. It is only up to 2 sigma. It is only up to 1.3 sigma. That means I need much data or I need optimization to enhance the significance. Then I did the optimization. Then we get some kind of an sophisticated optimization. We try to do a very optimization, very classical optimization. And there you see that I got 5 sigma, 4 sigma, 5 sigma, 4.5 sigma. That means if I do the optimization, I could have a discovery in our channel. Yeah. So that's basically we did it and that was published. And so then So there is one important point is that here, I didn't really mention here before. I think I don't have much time even also. I think I'll finish in 10 minutes. So there is one important parameter, which is called the H1SM. Yeah, that is important. So that means because the standard model, if you extend MSSM, you extend NMSSM. So, but the gauge group of the standard model doesn't enlarge. Even if you go to the NMSSM, so the standard model gauge boson is embedded there. So that means that some short of the scalar in my beyond standard model must contain the Higgs, the neutral Higgs that is the candidate within the standard model. So these are like a scenario that I am assuming the NMSSM, I have a 3 Higgs scalar, but I assume that H1, which is a standard model type. Yeah. Then we did the similar analysis for the FCC-HE. Recently, we did with Charles Dix, also with Professor Rosado and Jaime and Stefano Moretti from England. So then we did a Charles Dix. So can we go for a Charles Dix? Is also like a, some kind of the so whenever I have a doublet Higgs model, because I have a charged and I have a neutral, so the neutral gets the vague, but the charged gives. One gives the Goldstone mode and another gives the charge scalar, which is basically the charge Higgs in our any model. So then we try to find it out that can we find a charge Higgs in FCC HE collider? And this is under review, and last 2 years we haven't done anything, but I'm working last few months on that. But this is also similarly that can we have a charge Higgs signal, like a signal peak over the background? Yeah. And that is like a 4 sigma, but the result is not very, it need to be revised. So let us briefly, last 5-7 minutes, let me briefly devise that what is the supersymmetry at LHC. So if you see the superparticle mass reach at the LHC CMS, this is little older, I think 1 or 2 year older, more than 17, so 3 years older. So you see that these are like a maximum reach of the 2 TeV. So that means in this, all this kind of a channel, so the Large Hadron Collider, the CMS, the Central Muon Solenoid Collaboration, they try to find it around new superparticle. And they understood that they can exclude, these are kind of exclusion. They can exclude up to 2 TeV, any new particle mass scale. But this exclusion depends on a particular mode that you are looking for. There are thousands of mode and thousands of production channel. You have to really careful on each channel that how far you can go. In some channel you can go very far, in some channel you cannot go that far. Yeah, so these are, and similar Similar also you can find for the Atlas, because these are the Discovery 2 experiment, and this is also similar reach, that 2 to 3 TeV. If you don't find any superparticle within 2 to 3 TeV, you have a supersymmetry naturalness problem. Yeah, so that means I have to give up the supersymmetry that cures the problem of the unification or the hierarchy problem. Yeah, so people are really hopeful to get that. So we try to also did with Carlos Avila from Bogota and his student Jorge Fraga, and this is published in the, it was rejected in PRD, but it was published in IGMPA. So then we try to get for the supersymmetric TTH, because TTH is the channel that you can directly extract the EO-COR coupling of the top quark with the Higgs, as well as the gluon is basically strong coupling. This has a color, and the top quark is a very, very, very high flux in the LHC machine. So this is the process that is very interesting for a Higgs discovery as well. This is called the associated Higgs production with the top quark. And all the process, whatever the process you can think of, yeah, you can directly supersymmetrize. So, but supersymmetry, that should be by two. That means I have a T tilde, and H. That means top quark, and the Higgs. And we did that, and this is published. And then I really cannot go further, but I will show you that first you get the rate, and first you get the branching ratio, and then you exploit a different, which is called the MT2. This is called the transverse mass. The transverse mass, because whenever, so this is very important parameter for the collision discovery, because whenever I have a neutral particle, normally the neutral particle doesn't interact with the detector. For example, neutrino, chi10. So those gives the missing energy of a particle, missing energy signal, missing energy in our detector, because the energy should be conserved. But if you see that my energy is not conserved, that means something is missing. And those are the missing particle as the neutral particle, because that doesn't really interact with the electromagnetic or hadronic part of our detector component. So normally if it is a one particle or two particle missing, then you can really correct from the kinematics. But if there is a more than two particle or more than three particle that is missing, then you exploit the MT2. That means I have an endpoint distribution of the transverse mass MT2 variable. And by the endpoint distribution, it is something like a three body decay. Yeah, something like a Dalitz plot, something like a Dalitz plot in the B physics or in some other physics. So you can think from the endpoint measurement, you can really find or have a guess that what is the masses of the particle by the distribution of the endpoint, just like the Fermi electric sector. So you see the two body decay, but if it is a two body decay, you see that I should have a threshold, but the distribution is continuous. That tells you that I have a neutrino particle. It is something like that. So then we basically discovered or tried to make the cook up that which point is the large, for example, 3.7. And we understood that this 3.7 significance that we could go. I think I cannot go really much further because I think I don't have 2 or 3 minutes, but let me assume that we also worked with the non-universal. So remember, the universal means for example, think about the minimal supergravity. I started with the common Gaugino mass. So if I have a non-universal, that means the Gaugino common mass is not right. So then we did with a non-universal Gaugino mass model. So these are like a Gaugino mass in the U1, SU2, SU3. These are like a Clebsch-Gordan coefficient for the corresponding gauge group that you are embedded with. And M half N, this is the corresponding Gaugino mass parameter. And this C11 to 111 minus 1 minus 3 2, this 10 to 1, which is basically different representation of the gauge group of our enlarged model, which is like a 24, 75, 200. But this model has a beautiful feature that it naturally solved the muon G minus 2 anomaly that we did with one of the very famous physicists in India, Professor D.P. Roy. Probably many physics phenomenology community is very well known because he is one of the earlier particle physicists in India, and my supervisor is also a student of him. So he's a very but he passed away 3 years before. But we did that, and we tried to get again the new signal of the Higgs mass of 1.42 sigma of the charge in a discovery mode. And that was also published. So I think I really don't have much time for the neutrino physics at Collider. But Professor Brambilla, if you allow me just 2 minutes, I just...
Yes, don't worry. Go ahead, please. Okay.
So the neutrino physics is also another one of the physics that I am basically working. I mean, I'm not working at present, but we were working together with, in Spain, my supervisor, Professor Jose Valle, or my one of the supervisor in Bonn, Professor Herbert Dreiner, and another is Professor Manuel Dries. So Professor Herbert Dreiner and Professor Jose Valle are expert on neutrino physics. Professor Valle's book on neutrino physics. So we did with Professor Valle one of the work. So the main idea is that the main idea is basically coming from the Sanjanovic Mahapatra that they are trying to get that pair because you know the quark is a doublet in the standard model, and so these are like a quark doublet. These are the, like a fermion doublet, and this UCL, BCL, ECL, these are basically right-handed, but whenever I write the E charge conjugation with left-handed, that will behave as a right-handed quark. So that means I have an left-handed as well as the ECL. It is a right-handed, but since I don't have any right-handed neutrino in the standard model, so I try to find it out that I also know that in 1973 is a Wu experiment, they found it out that I have a parity violation. So they first, I think it's a Wu experiment, 1973 or 63. So they tried to find it out that I have a parity violation in the weak interaction. So what is the parity violation? That means I found the asymmetry maximal between left and right. If I have an asymmetry maximal between left and right, then I have a maximal parity violation. But I know that in the standard model, only left-handed fermion couples to the W boson. This is by construction, by the SU2L, which is like a W boson coupled to the lepton and the neutrino. And it is an SU2L, that SU2 special unitary 2+2 and left-handed doublet. There is no right-handed neutrino. And because I know that the any mass term of the fermion that is from M Schreiber-Schei, and if you go to the chiral projection of the M Schreiber-Schei, you see that M Schreiber-L Schei-R. If you get a projection with a Schreiber-Schei in between the projection operator, so that means there is no Schei-R. That means these two above leads to the neutrinos are massless in the standard model. So I don't have any neutrino mass in the standard model. So there is also like a interpretation of the neutrino, the non-zero fermion Dirac mass in the standard model. Then you have to go to the Weinberg mechanism. This is called the Weinberg mechanism. This is called that I get an L by I sigma 2. Sigma 2 is like a Pauli spin 2 matrices and phi is a scalar. So I have an Schreiber-Schei here. But this is because the fermion has a mass dimension 3/2. So if you count the numerator, you will see that it is more than, it is a 5, dimension 5 operator of the standard model of the Steven Weinberg, dimension 5 operator of the neutrino mass generation. But to get a new normalization, you have to have another scale, which is called the aim. Yeah, but then the theory is not renormalizable. So then there is also another mass, which is called the M Schreiber, LT and Schei-L. This is called the Majorana mass term, because this will, this Majorana mass term, there is also another quantum number, which is called the lepton number, quantum number. These basically violate the lepton number by 2 units. This is also another another constraint that I have a lepton number violation of 2 units that should generate the Majorana neutrino mass. So there are many important aspects with the whether the neutrino is a Dirac or neutrino is a Majorana. So these are basically the feature that you have to look for. For example, if you see in some kind of an experimental phenomenological observation that I have a delta L is equal to 2, I found that delta L is equal to 2, then probably the neutrino is a Majorana particle. Majorana means what is the Majorana nature? Majorana is that it is a self-antiparticle. The particle itself, it is self-antiparticle. I will discuss in the next day whenever we discuss about the Weyl formalism or the Majorana formalism in the context of the spin hub. But you need a renormalizable theory. There is also another mechanism, which is called the seesaw mechanism. This is, you introduce a gauge singlet new one. in the whole Lagrangian, and you define that my neutrino is a linear combination of nu L plus C nu bar L, or capital N, which is like another heavy singlet, which is like a nu R plus C nu R. So you are basically, you are having enlarging some kind of a new basis, and you basically mass matrices like a zero MD, MDT, and MR. So this MD are the Dirac block, and this MR is the is a new MR block. I mean, once you diagonalize this mass, this is some kind of a mass matrices. So if you diagonalize this mass matrices, you can see that I can have an MN, which is like a very close to the MR, and M nu, which is like a neutrino mass, which is like MDT, 1 over MN, MDT. This is like a teeny. So if MN is high, then the other Dirac is very low. So that means if one is very high, naturally, because of this mass matrix composition, the other is very low. If other is low, the other is very high. So it is like a seesaw. So that's why it is called a seesaw mechanism. So these are also very famous work by Mahapatro, Senjanovic, and Minkowski. So we worked with Professor Valle with SU2 left, SU2 right, and E1 B minus L. So this is like a B1 L, baryon number minus lepton number breaking model. And then we try to find it out the heavy singlet, like a capital N, Majorana mass term of the neutrino. In addition, can we see the lepton number violation signature in our model? We did that particular process with Professor Valle, and then try to find it out that heavy neutrino production and followed by the decay can lead to the Majorana nature of the neutrino with the same sign or the opposite sign dilepton. Because these are the same sign or the opposite sign like dilepton, it is basically gives you whether I have a delta L, which is the lepton number violation, is equal to 2 or not. Yeah, if it is a 2, that means it will give you the interpretation that I'm basically finding the intermediate heavy single neutrino, you know, which is basically the Majorana nature. And we did that. We did all kind of having all the kind of constraint, and we found that I could find a signal in particular in the di muon channel, in that particular channel. This is a little bit older, but I think I should stop it now. I think I cannot really go, but I think there is also one important that there is an R parity violation. There also you can have a neutrino mass model. That also I worked with Professor Harvey Dreiner, and also Diego Restrepo in Colombia, and Professor Valle, and all our collaboration. So there is also another model which is called the R parity. R parity is kind of a discrete Z2 symmetry. If you break the symmetry by explicitly, or there is also like a two way of breaking of the R parity violation symmetry. You can break by explicitly, or you can break by spontaneously, just like a similar like a NMSSM. So there also you can generate a Majorana mass term for the neutrino. And this is also one of the viable model for phenomenology called interpretation. I think one of the important aspect of this R parity violation is that this is the most important, is that you can find some kind of a displaced signature. What is the displaced signature in the experiment? Suppose you have a particle is produced at some point, and suppose the particle is traveled some point and it will decay from the secondary point. So in between, the particle is displaced. So this is a very important signature for a large hadron collider or any high energy collider to look for. So it's called the displaced signature. So one of the important aspect of this displaced signature is that if you find a displaced signature in your experiment, so you really don't have to work on the standard model background, because no known physics of the standard model have a possibility of the displaced signature other than the big quark, because big quark is discovered. I know the masses of the bottom quark. Yeah. So other than the bottom quark, there is no standard model particle that has any displaced signature. So I know bottom quark, so I know the background now for new physics. So if I found any displaced signature, that is a very interesting. And this decay width The decay weight depends on the display signature. So if I have an 10 to the power minus 4 or 10 to the power minus 2 electron volt order, any decay weight in a particular model, so I am expecting that I could get a display signature. And RPRT violation basically tells so. Even in the NMSSM tells so. I will come back one of the points. So these are the displaced vertexes. That means it is produced here and it is decay in the red point, and you calculate the LXY. So this we discussed with Fernando de Campos, Oscar Eboli, Mauricio Magro, W. Poro, Diego Restrepo, Martin Hirsch, and Jose Valle when I was in Valencia. As I said, that generally displaced vertex is standard model background free. So if you find something new, this is really new. Yeah. So you don't have to worry. So I think I just some possibility that can be studied for people are working. I don't know last 2 years, but I think these are the interesting event now that these are the limit that effective MSSM, that you start from the lambda k. Lambda k is like a product of coupling, but if lambda k goes to zero, then I can go to the NMSSM to the effective MSSM. Or if kappa goes to zero, this is called the Pechiquil limit. Or if ak, a lambda goes to zero, this is called the R symmetry limit. So R, Pechiquin, these are a very discrete symmetry, but this has a very profound phenomenological aspect of any model with the real observation with cosmology and so and so. And there is also light CP odd Higgs mass. This is a parity odd. This is also very, very interesting. So if you find any parity odd Higgs, a scalar particle in the experiment, there is also kind of a lambda plus kappa Vs. So there is a possibility of an accidental cancellation between the two term, and there probably you get a very light CP odd Higgs. And this is a very, very interesting characteristics of an NMSSM and displaced vertex, as I said. So these are the probably the very interesting region of the NMSSM that people are really looking for and people are working on. It's working since long, but it is still interesting to look for this kind of region in any model. As I said, the displaced Higgs with NMSSM, this is also my interest, basically. I'm basically interested on that can I find a displaced Higgs signature at the Large Hadron Collider or the Future Collider within the NMSSM? Because NMSSM, the parameters such that I could have a displaced Higgs signature. So this is one of the interesting, Matt Strassler, David Kaplan from, David Kaplan is the LACB collaboration. Sisava Sisaki is a famous from Cornell. Matt Strassler probably moved from somewhere. So they are very expert in these Higgs displaced signature within exotic model. So people are working on, and I'm also basically interested to working on. So I think let me finish by having this summary. So I think I discussed about NMSSM, MSSM, and few collision, and there are few scenario for H1, H2 scenario. And as I said, that in the NMSSM, displaced Higgs signature at the LHC are very important, and people are really working now to look for, because you can find the because you don't, the most important is that you don't care about the background, yeah? And people are, and very interesting signal. And low mass neutrino with displaced lightest supersymmetric particle or LHC RPRT violation model, that was also interesting. So I think with that, I just stop for today for the phenomenology. And thank you so much for all of you for your attention.
Thanks a lot, Siva. If there is any question, any comments? If you want to ask something, you can do by chat also in Spanish, yeah. And we can translate. If not, okay, Siva, so we will continue next week. Is okay with you at the same hour? Yeah. If you want to tell us what are you going to talk next week?
Yes, so Prof, I was basically starting with the I tried to start from the supersymmetry algebra. For example, I start with spatial Lorentz 2C, SL2C, SO3-1, yes. And then start how the spin-hop representations that you can go with SL2C, and then basically you enlarge your fermion representation, and then basically you get back to the Poincaré algebra, because there basically you have an Grassmann operator, and introduce two operator that has an Grassmann property, and these two operators connected with the Lorentz translation, which is like a the graded Lie algebra. So then you basically have a formalism of the how the Grassmann is connected with the Lorentz translation, and then you basically like a super field formalism, a little bit about the superspace, and then how you can write a supersymmetric invariant Lagrangian from the superfield. And just briefly the Weiss-Gumino model, and then how the gauge interactions or the chiral superfield, vector superfield introduction will construct the superpotential and the super Lagrangian, supersymmetric Lagrangian. And from the supersymmetric Lagrangian, how you can get the scalar Lagrangian, and then the scalar potential, where I started. So I try to touch just to have a basic construction and get back to up to the scalar potential.
Okay. Siva, there is a question in the, oh, in the chat. Can you read your chat?
Just do it.
Or Brian, if you want to talk, or you can read Siva.
So Shiva, could you tell us a little bit about the future of SUSE, but from our own point of view? I mean, do you believe that people will find something? Probably you could mention something about gravitons, gravitinus. Yeah. So thank you, Brian. So as I said to you that, just let me go to the CMS and the MSSM. You have to be a little bit. Focus on this page 36. This is a 2017 module. So you understood that last 2 years I'm not working on anything. So not even changing the slide. So what I mean to say that this is the like a PP going to Gluino. Yeah. So here, as I said, that probably most of the working on the minimal, my slides are basically most on the minimal supergravity aspect, but I really don't have an exclusion plot for the GMSB, which is called the gravitational mediated or the gauge mediated supersymmetry breaking. There probably you have an naturally the gravitational comes up, or there are I don't know any other. I mean, other than the GMSB, I really don't know any other model that you could have an. Probably gravitational mediated supersymmetry breaking or so and so, but I really don't have much idea at the moment. But what I said to you that the gravitational part, I really don't know much. So what you ask about the about gravitinus, no. As I said to you that I don't have the recent exclusion here, but you can see that easily 2TeV. 2TeV, you cannot really reach further. 2TeV or 3TeV, they say that the minimal supergravity is almost like excluded from the Gluino search. Yeah. So the three. So this is basically like a. If you don't have a 3TeV, if you don't find Gluino before the 3TeV, then basically your minimal supergravity is ruled out almost, because you are having a same problem with the naturalness. You introduce the naturalness problem again, but as I said, that our trick is different, because we are working on the scalar sector. So even though the minimal supergravity is ruled out, but there is some pocket which is called a very difficult region. For example, one of the important issues is the top square, because of the RG running and the color factor. So the top square could be very, very light. Yeah. So then because the top square, if you see the y-axis here, the squares, you can see the top square is not excluded that far. So that means still I have an enough range of the white space is there. So that means, so you try to look for the more white region and look for that particular channel. Yeah. So that means, so the Gluino channel is almost exhausted up to 2 dB, but there are still room from the other channel. So then that's why the people are looking for the other channel. But I really don't know about the, what you said about the, what is the current result of the LSC people looking for? I really don't have much idea at the moment, but the scalar is Higgs is one of the issue. Displaced vortex is one of the issue people are working on still for any non-exotic, non-beyond standard model scalar displaced signature. And precision, Higgs precision measurement. Higgs precision measurement, there are recent update from the Higgs precision measurement from the recent luminosity, but I really don't know the coupling. But what I share, what I told in one of the slides about this kappa TT, kappa BB, those are the like a range of coupling. I don't have the plot, but those are constrained also. Precision measurement, could you comment about it? I really don't have at the moment, no update. Also comment about if you could relate the search with supersymmetry with the current LS people looking for new physics through the Higgs precision. Could you comment about it? Also comment if you could relate this searches with supersymmetry search. So as I said, that I really don't have very recent update from the Higgs scalar, but I know that people are working on, and I will have a look. As I said, people are more interested on display signature, and this is one of the issue people are looking for. Other than anything, I really don't have much very recent update, but we can discuss about that. Or maybe next week I will little brief about what is the latest precision, Higgs precision, or the latest status of the supersymmetry, just for a slide like this, the CMS, maybe the gravitational context. But I really don't have much idea at the moment.
Okay. María Eugenia y Brian Larios, ¿nos pueden decir de dónde, en dónde están? Nada más para llevar el control.
María, maybe I'm asking. María Eugenia is a very good friend of mine. She is a professor at the USAC, and she works on supersymmetry. She works on dark matter, and we are a very good friend. And also Brian Larios is also good friend of all of us. He is in Honduras. I also told them, Brian and Melissa, they are at Honduras. Uh-huh. They also work on supersymmetry breaking, supersymmetry formalism, gravitino mediated supersymmetry breaking, and LACB physics. Melissa works on the experimental aspect of the LACB, on the B physics aspect. So.
Y este, ¿qué es USAC? Universidad de dónde son? USAC is the University of where?
San Carlos.
Okay.
The government university where Giovanni Ramirez is a professor.
Yeah, San Carlos, Guatemala. Gracias. Es que acá en México hay otra USAC. Ya, muchas gracias. Gracias, María Eugenia. Brian, ¿alguna otra pregunta? Some other question? If not, we will stop here. Thanks a lot, Siva, and we will see you next week. And everybody's welcome. If there is any students or professors that want to join us, please. So next week. We'll see you.
Thank you
bye
so
bye,
much.
Siva. Thanks a lot, Siva.